The good sign, on the other hand, is on the side of the public. Despite all this repeated, deliberate fomentation of hatred and difference, people keep saying, no, we still want to keep our country peaceful. We still want to live with other ethnic groups in peace. All we want is our rights to be respected. The other very good thing that's happening is, at least among the opposition, we have started for the first time hearing that these different ethnic-based organizations have come together and say, at the end of the day, what we want is a real democracy in our country. If a real democracy comes, then these ethnic conflicts can be seriously addressed. So those are the two trends that are taking place. And my hope is that the opposition gathers the strength so that it can stop this deliberate conflict that's being created by the government.
Earlier today, Amnesty International's representative, Mr. Ekwe, spoke at great length, particularly in his written submission, about the use of torture. And I'm wondering, I've raised torture many times. I've written laws to combat torture, raised it in our Ethiopia Human Rights Act, you know, as one of the conditionalities. Why were people so disbelieving? Or why did they look askance? I'm talking about our own government under President Bush, as well as under President Obama. You know, it's there in black and white, and it seems to get looked over. We look askance. Why is that?
Congressman Smith, I honestly think to a certain degree it's part of human nature. You want to believe what you want to believe. You want to believe not the facts on the ground, not what you see, but what you think is the thing that you need to believe in order to do what you are doing continuously. The U.S. administration has historically been interested in Ethiopia on security and other grounds. The U.S. administration wants to continue the relationship with Ethiopia. In order to do that, it has to come to terms with this issue of a brutal regime that is torturing its own people, that's killing its own people. Then how do you mesh the two? Usually, the human mind, I think, plays tricks on you. Then you say, it's not happening. I mean, you know, or you try to ignore it. You try to think as if it is not happening. It is denial. That is exactly what is going on in the policy-making circles of the United States and Europe. They just don't want to believe what they see, because then they have to do something about it. Right. Then they have to do something real about it. And they can't do anything real about it. They don't want to do anything real about it.
Let me ask you, you spent some considerable time in your testimony on the interference in religious affairs, and you talked about the manipulation of the leadership of the patriotic, of the Orthodox Church. Could you expound upon that? Because that is a very serious assertion, and it seems to me that, you know, we do have the International Religious Freedom Act. There is both a commission which has written about these issues before. Relative to Ethiopia, it would seem to me this should be an engraved invitation to do it again to them. And we also have the IRFA office at the U.S. Department of State. In your view, how bad is it?
Oh, it really is bad. I mean, it's bad to the point where I think the U.S. institution that deals with religious freedom recently had a hearing, I think, on the issue of the Muslims. And for the first time openly acknowledged that this was a result of gross interference. In fact, a deliberate taunting, as if, you know, because when you say Muslim and terrorism, the two come together, and the Ethiopian government thinks that by calling them terrorists, while it actually is taking away their own religion and trying to impose its will on them, with the Orthodox Church, this is the first time in Ethiopian history that the Orthodox Church is openly split into two. There is the patriarch elected by the government and its supporters, and the exiled patriarch. As you know, the basic rule in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church is you don't change a patriarch till the patriarch dies.
Right.
And this government came and changed the patriarch while he was still alive. And the patriarch left, and he has now created around him another synodos where most people in the diaspora are now. This is the first time in Ethiopian history that the Ethiopian Orthodox Church was purposely split. The same thing they are trying to do with the Muslims. This is, as I said in my written statement, it is a government that is allergic to the existence of any independent body. Whether it's religious, whether it's, they have to be under their control. That's what they are doing. Unfortunately, as you know, religion is a very sensitive thing. As you push people, then they start to resist. That's exactly what the Muslims are doing. That's what we will expect that the Christians would be doing too.
Two final questions.
Sure.
The Charities and Societies Proclamation Law, which I think gets very little notice in Washington, gets some, but it seems to me it ought to be getting much more because it does have an anti-terrorism, and under the rubric of terrorism, a whole lot of bad things can be pushed. Could you, to the committee, tell us what you think is the worst aspects of that law?
The worst, if I have to pick one worst aspect, there is this 5 areas in the law that deals with any institution that deals with human rights, that deals with children's rights, that deals with reconciliation, that deals with, I forgot the other two, anything that has to do with human rights, and any institution that deals with these issues cannot get foreign funding, period. Now, anybody who knows Ethiopia, all NGOs, all these institutions operate on the basis of projects that they put to foreign donors. All of them are closed now. 90% of these institutions are closed. So, if I have to pick one terrible aspect of this law, it is the fact that everything that has to do with human rights and good governance is completely out from Egypt.